Just before we get started, did you know that 2 out of every 3 guys will experience some form of male pattern baldness by the time they're 35? Who would have thought that? Irish Keeps have been around when I was younger because advancements in science meant that there are now treatments that can help combat the symptoms of hair loss and help you keep the hair that you have. Though it's too late for me, my hair is not coming back, but you don't have to be like me. You can stop your hair loss early. Thanks to Keeps. Keeps offers generic versions of the only 2 FDA-approved drugs for treating hair loss. So you might have tried them before, but you've never tried them at a price this low. That's right, if you were thinking, oh, that's some sort of medicine, Simon, it's probably going to be expensive. You couldn't be more wrong. Keeps starts at just $10 a month. How does it work? Well, for one thing, don't need to go to the doctor's office, just schedule a quick online consult, and a bit later, discreet package arrives, and you use that in the privacy of your own home. So if you're noticing that you're losing your hair, that's a problem that's not going to fix itself. Do something about it for a limited time. Go to keeps.com/brainfood or click the link in the description below to save 50% off your first order. And now, today's video. During the Vietnam War, the greatest enemy faced by the US forces was not the North Vietnamese Army or the Viet Cong, but the country itself. The rugged terrain and thick jungles of Vietnam were ideal for fighting a defensive war, allowing Vietnamese forces to move men and material undetected, stage deadly ambushes, and melt away into the undergrowth. In desperation, the Americans turned to ever more outlandish methods to locate and track their elusive enemy, from training hunting dogs to airdropping thousands of electronic motion sensors disguised as human and animal droppings over the jungle. But perhaps the strangest weapon in the American arsenal was the People Sniffer, a device designed to track enemy troops using their body odor. Developed by General Electric and the US Army Chemical Corps at the Limited Warfare Laboratory in Aberdeen, Maryland, the People Sniffer, officially the E-36 personnel detector, was designed to detect the ammonia in human sweat and urine. The device worked by sucking in air through a sampling hose into a testing chamber, exposing it to hydrochloric acid vapor. Any ammonia in the air reacted with the acid to form a cloud of white ammonia chloride vapor, whose density, and thus the ammonia concentration, was measured by passing light through the testing chamber. In addition to the sweat and urine, the device could also detect other indicators of human activity, such as smoke from campfires and small arms fire. But as exotic as the People Sniffer was, it was nowhere near as bizarre as some of the earlier human detection techniques studied by the Limited Warfare Laboratory. Starting in 1961, the laboratory conducted a series of experiments aimed at developing a personnel detector based on, of all things, insects. Dozens of blood-sucking insects and other creatures, including bedbugs, lice, oriental rat fleas, lone star ticks, 3 mosquito species, and triatomine, or kissing bugs, were exposed to human sweat, and their behavior was observed. The species which moved most aggressively were then moved into special chambers with flexible mesh walls and musical instrument-style acoustic pickups meant to detect and amplify the insects' movements into a usable signal. However, the insects' movements proved too random to produce reliable detection, and the project was soon abandoned. The E-36 personnel detector was first field tested in Vietnam in late 1966 under the supervision of chemist John D. Baldeschweiler. The following year, it was more widely deployed as part of Operation Snoopy, with the devices being issued to troops of the 503rd Chemical Detachment allocated to the 199th Infantry Brigade. There were 2 versions of the E-36 produced, the first being the portable XM2. This consisted of a hard shell pack carried on an infantryman's back with a sampling hose attached to a standard-issue M16 assault rifle. While the troops were initially enthusiastic about the fancy new gadget, in combat the XM2 proved troublesome to use. For one thing, it was found to be a little too sensitive, often detecting the sweat of the men using it and forcing the operator to march much further ahead and upwind of the rest of the squad. The device also made a loud chirping sound, which made patrols extremely vulnerable to detection and attack. Troops soon came to view the XM2 as a liability, and it was quickly withdrawn from service. Far more successful was the XM3, designed to be mounted on helicopters. From 1967 onwards, People Sniffer helicopters flew almost daily Snoopy missions, skimming above the treetops at altitudes as low as 150 meters in search of enemy troop concentrations hidden beneath the canopy below. At these altitudes, the climate of Vietnam actually worked to the Sniffer's advantage, as the constant rain tended to wash away all airborne contaminants, leaving only human effluents behind. The forward motion of the helicopter also prevented the sniffers from detecting their own crews. When an area of high ammonia concentration was detected, the helicopter crew would call in an artillery or airstrike on the position or drop canisters of tear gas to flush the enemy out of hiding. According to an official U.S. Army report, these patrols were highly effective, with over one-third of significant detector readings being confirmed by troop contacts with enemy on the ground. But the device was not perfect and could easily be thrown off by strong winds, the presence of nearby civilian settlements, and even the local wildlife. As helicopter pilot Peter Rogers recounted in 2002, "We flew directly over a tree full of 20 to 30 birds' nests, and as we went over it, the operator said, 'Mark 10, which is the maximum,' and I immediately radioed and said, 'No, cancel that, we've just flown over a tree full of birds' nests.' Too late. It went into the books. The next day, they put a B-52 strike on the tree." The enemy also developed low-tech methods for defeating the people sniffers. In an absurdist microcosm of the Vietnam War as a whole, the Viet Cong took to hanging buckets of urine and mud in the trees and then moving on, leading the Americans to expend countless tons of high-tech ordnance on empty jungle. Similar tactics were deployed against U.S. Army sniffer dogs, with the Viet Cong using soap, aftershave, garlic, and chili peppers to throw the animals off the scent. Smoke from small arms fire was harder to conceal, however, and the Viet Cong soon learned to hold their fire when Snoopy missions passed overhead. In response, the Americans took to disguising Snoopy helicopters as gunships in order to draw easily detectable fire from the ground. These missions were always flown by at least three helicopters, one carrying the people sniffer and two gunships to protect it. As the war dragged on, these missions became ever more dangerous, with the pilot Martin Liddy reporting that, "There is no room for error down there, and one shot could bring you down. But that gadget is really something." As effective as they were in isolation, however, the results of the Snoopy missions were too haphazard to have a major strategic impact on the war, and the Americans eventually turned to a much cruder tactic, destroying the jungle itself to deny the Viet Cong cover. In 1968, the U.S. Army acquired a pair of modified logging vehicles called Tactical Tree Crushers to literally steamroll their way through the jungle. While these behemoths performed well in testing, clearing 4 acres of thick brush every hour, their engines proved unreliable, and their slow speed and tall profile made them vulnerable to enemy ambushes, and they were never used in combat. Instead, the army tried to burn down the jungle using napalm and other incendiaries dropped from aircraft. However, the trees in Vietnam proved too wet to burn, and even where forest fires did catch, the water vaporized by the fires quickly condensed into clouds and fell as rain, putting out the flames. In desperation, the Americans turned to chemical herbicides or defoliants, the most infamous of which was, of course, Agent Orange. Vietnam was not the first time that Agent Orange had been used in combat. 20 years prior, the British had used the defoliant against communist guerrillas during the Malayan Emergency, a war of independence fought between 1948 and 1960. Nor was Agent Orange the only defoliant used during the war, with the U.S. Army Chemical Corps deploying a whole range of so-called rainbow herbicides manufactured by Monsanto and Dow Chemical, including Agents Green, Pink, Purple, Blue, and White. Starting in January 1962, the U.S. Air Force began spraying rainbow herbicides over vast swaths of Vietnamese jungle as part of Operation Ranch Hand, whose official motto was, and we really wish we were making this up, "Only you can prevent a forest." Over the next 10 years, the Air Force would drop nearly 76 million liters of defoliants on Vietnam, destroying 20,000 square kilometers of forest and thousands of square kilometers of crops. The aim of the campaign was twofold. First, as previously noted, to deny the Viet Cong the cover of the jungle, especially around strategic locations like cities, large towns, and military bases. More sinister, however, the operation also formed part of a wider policy known as forced draft urbanization, which was meant to force Vietnamese peasants off their land and into cities, denying the Vietnamese their rural support base. But the long-term effects of defoliant use would go far beyond deforestation and population displacement. Agent Orange, a 50-50 mixture of the herbicides 2,4-5-T and 2,4-D, turned out to be contaminated with traces of 2,3,7-8 tetrachlorobenzo-p-dioxin, an extremely persistent and toxic substance capable of inflicting all manner of horrific health effects, like skin lesions called chloracne, cancer, and severe birth defects, including cleft palate, spina bifida, and abnormal development of the teeth, eyes, and sexual organs. According to the Vietnamese government and the Red Cross, approximately 4 million Vietnamese people were exposed to Agent Orange during the war, with up to 3 million suffering permanent illness or disability as a result of the exposure. But the Air Force's efforts to drive the Viet Cong from the jungle ultimately proved futile, and the United States withdrew from Vietnam in 1975, leaving behind a toxic legacy of pain and suffering. In the end, the failure of the people sniffers, Agent Orange, and other sophisticated U.S. weaponry to turn the tide of the battle served as a potent reminder that against a determined enemy, it takes far more than technology to win a war. So I do hope you found today's video interesting. If you did, please do use that like button below. Don't forget to subscribe, and as always, thank you for watching.